Get seated. Where's Eli? Yeah, never. Where's Emma? Okay. No worries, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. All right, let's go. All right, I'm gonna start the meeting for the Corpus Christi RTA meeting. Could we do the Pledge of Allegiance by our U.S. veteran Frank Newell? Frank Newell was born and raised in the Rio Grande Valley and is a U.S. Navy veteran. Mr. Newell reported for duty on board the USS Lindy McCormick, DDG-8, in San Diego, California, and USS Dale, CG-19, in Mayport, Florida. He graduated from Texas A&M University, Corpus Christi, with a Bachelor of Applied Science degree in Community and Mental Health. Mr. Newell began his career with Nueces County over 28 years ago and is currently the cemetery manager for the Coastal Bend State Veterans Cemetery. Frank views his position as an opportunity to serve veterans and their families from a ministry perspective, and that it is his Christian duty to fulfill one aspect of the corporal works of mercy by honoring the fallen. Mr. Newell, thank you so much for your service, and we really are honored that you're here today. Appreciate you. Please lead us in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Newell, would you like to say a few words real quick? Or? Okay. Well, thank you for your service, sir. Appreciate you. All right. Marisa, will you please call the roll?
Dan Weindecker.
Here.
Ana Jimenez.
Here.
Lynn Allison.
Present.
Gabby Canales.
Present.
Beatrice Chottle.
Here.
Jeremy Coleman. Armando Gonzalez. Arthur Granado.
Present.
Erica Mady.
Here.
Thank you, Marisa. Agenda item three, excuse me, the safety briefing. Mr. Esparza. You don't look like Mr. Esparza. Good morning, Mike.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, directors. Sorry you got this UT guy here doing the safety briefing. But in serious, as you all have in front of you, the top 10 hurricane essential items that you must have. We are in the critical time in August and September where hurricanes usually get active. 6 years ago, August 17, 2017, Harvey hit. So we're real close to that season, mid-August all the way to September. So, and also on your second page, you have a category 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Harvey was a 4 when it was just started as 1, and it just grew on. And so Marisa has emailed you this information so you can share it with families and friends. So that's important information. And for our safety briefing today is, if there's an emergency in this facility, we'll exit to my right, your left, you'll go out through the kitchen, exit the west side doors, report to assembly number 3, which is the clock tower adjacent to the transfer station. Do not utilize the elevator during the process. Do not return unless the all clear has been given. And if we have to shelter in place, we'll shelter on the west side stairwell. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Excuse me. Agenda item 4, received a conflict of interest affidavits. Marisa, do we have any? Thank you, ma'am. Agenda item 5, administer the oath of office for the City of Corpus Christi appointee, Mr. Arthur Granado.
You would stand here, please raise right your hand and repeat after me.
Will do.
I state your name.
I, Arthur Granado.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will faithfully execute the duties.
That I will faithfully execute the duties.
Of the office of board member.
Of the office of board member.
Of the Corpus Christi Regional Transportation Authority.
Of the Corpus Christi Regional Transportation Authority.
And will to the of the state of Texas.
And the state of Texas.
And will to the best of my ability.
And will to the best of my ability.
Preserve, protect, and defend.
Preserve, protect, and defend.
The Constitution and laws of the United States.
The Constitution and laws of the United States.
And of this state.
And of this state.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Wonderful. So, welcome, Art. Welcome, Art. Hey, Art, you want to say a few words or anything? You can stand over here since you're up here. Congratulations, Art. Hey, Art, wait, you need to be on the microphone. Sorry. The first rule.
There you go. Okay, again, just want to say, want to thank the City of Corpus Christi for affording me the opportunity to be on this board. I look forward to serving on this Transportation Authority. I know many of you on this board. I've worked with you on various other boards and committees. I look forward to learning a lot from you because you've been here for some time, and also the ones I do not know, hope to get to know you. And to also get some input, some valuable input of what you have on this board. And to these employees, I look forward to continuing the best of my ability to make sure this this Transportation Authority still serves your best interest and make sure we have efficient, clean buses. I think we've done a really good job. I've actually utilized the bus system itself, so it's a great system. The buses are extremely clean, well conditioned, and I want to make sure that the riders understand that I'll do my best to make sure that I continue to do what this board has done to make sure that continues to be operated in that manner. So other than that, again, I want to thank the City of Corpus Christi. I look forward to serving here. If you have any questions or things, feel free to look me up, and I'll do my best to answer those questions for you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Director Granado, and congratulations again.
Thank
welcome.
You, appreciate it.
Welcome. All right, we're on agenda item 6, opportunity for public comment. We have a 3-minute limit. The board cannot discuss anything back towards the public discussion. Any public comments, Marisa?
There was one received online, which everybody has a copy there at your seat. And we do have some signed up.
Hey, Dan, just to let you know, I've logged on.
Armando's on.
Armando's on. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Director. Ms. Harden, are you there? Seeing no further public comment, I'll move on the agenda. Agenda item number 7, our awards and recognition, one of my favorite parts of the agenda. Agenda item 7A, our CCRTA new hires. Derek?
All right, directors, I wanted to start something new by bringing in our new employees and welcoming them to our organization as they begin their careers and give the board a chance to see the face of the RTA here. So in June and July, we have the following bus operators begin their careers: Victor Krupala, Leslie Smith, Edwin Hawkins, Jonathan Harden, Miranda Cruz, Crystal English, Joshua Ozuna, Israel Rojas, and our marketing specialist, Shaylee Patterson. And then we have our DBE certification specialist, Teodoso Gonzalez. So if you all would, rise up, and then if the board would like, we could take some photos with the...
That'd be wonderful.
...with the new employees.
Welcome, y'all. Let's take a quick pic. Thank you.
Let's get two rows in.
Okay, now we're on agenda item 7B, the 2022 Certificate of Achievement for the Excellence in Financial Reporting.
The Finance Department has been awarded the Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting for its ACFR presentation of the 2021 financial statements. The Certificate of Achievement is the highest form of recognition in governmental accounting and financial reporting, and its attainment represents a significant accomplishment by a government agency and its management. This marks the 18th consecutive award and the 25th since 1989 that the CCRTA has received. All members of our authority, including all of our employees and our directors, play a vital role in achieving this award. But I want to really congratulate Robert and Sandy, who has her finance team here, for once again achieving this financial recognition. So would Sandy come on up with your team? One more another chance for some photo opportunity.
Photo op. That's all right. Bring on. If you don't mind, Sandy, would you introduce everybody? Or Robert?
Oh, absolutely.
Yes, please.
Robert.
Before we come to we don't know him.
Cunha. She is our payroll administrator. Angelica Acevedo, our accountant. And this is Daniel. He is our comptroller.
Matocayo. Nice to meet y'all. Well, we'll come right on down and congratulations, y'all, and thank you so much for such hard work, and this is quite the accomplishment.
Well, we're very happy to...
You want to read the plaque for us? Please step
yes,
into the microphone.
Absolutely.
Read it in the microphone, please, so everybody...
Well, this right here is the plaque that we first received back in 2012, and it just, every year we get a medallion. Of course, we've had more awards since then, before then.
Yes, ma'am.
But we're working on 2022. So what it says is Government Finance Officers Association Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Finance Reporting presented to the Corpus Christi Regional Transportation Authority.
Wonderful. Congratulations.
Thank you.
As always, an excellent job, Robert and Sandy, and your team.
We're going to take a pic.
Okay. One more pic, guys. Sorry, wellness program.
No, you need to step to the chance. None of us all know. The rest of us got up.
Congratulations, well deserved.
right, now to some more business here. We're under agenda item 8, discussion and possible action to approve the board minutes of the board of directors meeting of July 12, 2023. You had it in your packet. Any additions, deletions, corrections? If not, I'll entertain a motion. I have a motion by Director Salazar. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
I have a second by Director Canales. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please state by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. All right, agenda item 9, this is the consent items. The following items are routine or administrative in nature and have been discussed previously by the board or committees. The board has been furnished with support documentation on these items. We have agenda item 9A, B. Do I have to read these out, John? I don't think so. Just A and B. Okay. Agenda item 9A, action to authorize executing a memorandum of agreement with Texas A&M University Corpus Christi Transportation Services. And 9B, action to award multiple contracts on CD Starter, Cummins Southern Plains, Gillig LLC, Kirk's Automotive Inc., Model 1, Muncie, Rush Trucks, Texas Alternator Starter Service, and White Associates for external and internal engine parts. Does anybody want to pull anything off the consent agenda? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second. Thank you, Ms. Chottle. All in favor, please state by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Agenda item 10, discussion and possible action to adopt a resolution designating certain persons to sign checks on all bank accounts held by Frost Bank, the authority's depository bank. Mr. Saldana, you have the floor, sir.
Good morning. Robert Saldana, Managing Director of Administration. So this aligns with the board priority of public image and transparency. Just a little background. Section 451, specifically point 101 of the Texas Government Code, it allows the board of directors to designate certain people, staff members, as well as directors, board directors, check signing authority in order to meet our fiscal demands on an annual basis. Because it's more of a digital stamp and it's easier to just stamp with everybody's name in here, we put certain control methods in place. We segregate job duties. We separate the authorization process as well as the processing of distributions, disbursements. We conduct internal reviews of our AP batches before we disperse any funds. On a monthly basis, we reconcile our bank statements. We have our system control, the unique number that it's put on each invoice. And we conduct annual audits on a cash management disbursements on an annual basis, obviously. We have four different accounts that this covers: our main account with Frost Bank, our payroll account, our claims, which is our healthcare account, and our lockbox. So these changes here are for the main account, the payroll account, and the lockbox. We're changing Chairman Leindecker's from board secretary at one time to chair, adding Director Jimenez as board vice chair, adding Director Allison as secretary. We're adding our CEO, Derek Majak, adding Mike Rendon as a deputy CEO. No changes to myself. And then we're deleting our former CEO and then the former board chair and former vice chair. So for our medical claims, it's a little bit more on here. It's the same changes up front, and then the last two names, actually the same two names, the middle here, Dixie Gunning actually works for Intrust, and Mac Meadows works for Intrust, and they're part of the distribution as well, too, in the signing. All the other changes are the same. Just kind of the summary of it, the modifications, obviously, Chairman Leindecker and Mr. Rendon, adding Director Jimenez, Director Allison, and our CEO, Derek Majak. And then the deleting of the former CEO, the board chair, and board vice chair. That's just a summary of the changes now that who will be on the signature authority for signing of checks in those four major accounts. There is no DBE. There is no federal funds involved. In fact, there's no funds actually involved at all. It's just a process of a change. So at this time, staff requests the board of directors authorize the chief executive officer or designee to adopt a resolution designating certain persons to sign checks on all accounts held at Frost Bank, the authority's depository bank. And I'll take any questions you may have.
Great. Any questions for Robert? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Thank you, Director Chattel. I now have a second. Thank you, Director Canales. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. All right, we're on agenda item 11, discussion and possible action to adopt the 2023 Public Transportation Agency Safety Plan, PTASP, version 2, amended manual. Mr. Rendon.
Good morning again.
Good morning.
Directors. So it is the board priority under safety and security. A little background, in July of 2019, FTA implemented the requirement that all public transit agencies receiving federal funding must implement a public transportation agency safety plan, which is known throughout the industry as a PTAS. And that's to control risk better, detect and correct safety issues, share and analyze safety data more effectively, and measure safety performance throughout the year. In July of 2020, Board of Directors did approve the version 1. February of 2022, FTA sent out a notice to advising of the new bipartisan infrastructure law change, and it says that it must create a safety committee and under focus on the vehicle and pedestrian accidents, transit worker assaults, and performance targets. The comprehensive safety training program they added to, which is a de-escalation training for bus operators, focus on them, and assault on transit operators. We added mandatory active shooter training up to last month. In July of this year, there's been 484 active shooter incidents, so that's an average of more than one a day. And I'll focus a little bit more on that on my safety report. And just to advise you guys and know that 60% of the assaults that happen on the bus operators, it has to do with fair dispute. So we advise them that if somebody does not want to pay, continue going to the transfer station, call for a supervisor, and let them handle that for safety reasons. And so there's four pillars to the PTAS, which is the safety promotion that's done through marketing, safety risk management, prioritizing management safety, and safety assurance to monitor each transit safety performance. Safety management policy comes from our CEO all the way down to the mechanic and maintenance people, that everybody has to buy into this program. Safety program. And so the new bipartisan infrastructure requires that for procedures, that we must have procedures for exposure in an infection disease, and we must have a safety committee and a program that reduce reduction on incidents. And the safety training, like I said, assault on transit operators, de-escalation, and the active shooter class that is mandatory. We had up to 9 classes. We got a couple more to go, and we have already trained over 200. About 98% of our employees have gone through this, and the other couple percent is that because they're either on vacation or in sick and they're out, but they will go through this training. And then common type of changes, we have our new CEO, Derry Majek, was moved up to deputy, and we have a supervisor and a bus operator that joined the safety committee. For every supervisor, we must have a frontline employee. And these are common types of changes. Like I said, our new CEO, myself, and then we added another managing director. So we have four managing directors in our chain of command, one deputy CEO, and of course, our CEO. So at this time, we request that the board of directors adopt the 2023 PTAS version 2 amended. Any questions?
Any questions for Mr. Rendon? Hearing none, I entertain a motion.
So moved.
I have a motion by our vice, Madam Vice Chair. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Director Salazar. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same
aye.
Sign. Motion carries. Thank you, Mike. All right, agenda item 12. This is going to be a little long read here, but real quick, and Mr. Bill will help me at the end. Discussion and possible action to amend the bylaws in the following manner. 12A, are we going to vote on these separately or together?
It could be separate. Well, I think it probably would make sense. But either way, it's the board's pleasure.
Okay.
And, I can walk through the
I was just thinking that way all the officers can line up at the same time. So let's vote these together, please. It's going to be discussion and possible action to amend the bylaws in the following manner. A, an amendment changing the election of the board chair from January in even-numbered years to October in odd-numbered years to be effective with the election in January 2024, so that the term of the next board chair and thereafter shall expire September 30th, 2025 on odd-numbered years. And then B, an amendment changing the election of the vice chairman, secretary, and any assistant secretaries from January in even number years to October in odd number years to be effective with the elections in January 2024, so that such terms shall expire in September 30th, 2025. So I'll just be brief here and John will jump in. Right now, since we have elections in January, if you get elected, you cannot get elected in your sixth year because we have 8-year terms. So you can't be elected as an officer, either as chairman, vice chairman, or secretary, or assistant secretary. If you are in your sixth year running in January. And what this will do is line it up to where you can do that, according to our appointment times. If that makes any sense. John, did I just mess that all up or?
Well, it really only applies to the board chair. The other officers, their terms are fixed by whether they're appointed by the city or the county or the committee of mayors. And that's their term of office. Their officer position is just while they're a member of the board. But the board chair, since the board chair is appointed by the rest of the board, that's your term of office is fixed in that regard. But a little history is helpful in that we had our sales tax and confirmation election in August of 1985, and after that election, the five initial board members appointed by the city were joined by four more board members, two appointed by the county and two appointed by the mayor's council in September of 1985. And then at that first board meeting in October of 1985, those 10 members elected a new board chair. Because the state law specifies that when you have a transit authority board of this type, the 10 board members then elect an 11th board member to be the board chair. And that board chair can be someone currently on the board or someone that's not on the board. Historically, it's always been someone who was on the board. And so Pat Eisenhower was the first board chair. She was appointed initially by the city. The city then fills a vacancy. And that went along then with the board chair being elected in October of every odd-numbered year until 2013 when the board decided to extend the term of the board chair and have board elections in January of even-numbered years. the thought process being that you had four new board members coming on from the county and the mayor's panel, and at their first meeting they were called upon to elect a board chair and new officers, and it was thought it would give them a little bit of experience before they had that decision. As the board chair mentioned, state law mandates that none of you can serve more than 8 years, and it specifies that you can't be appointed to a term that would extend beyond 8 years. And so as a result, when in the situation of anyone who is appointed by the county or the mayor's panel who would take office in October, if that person became board chair, they would only be able to serve a maximum of 6 years and 3 months, because they couldn't be appointed after 6 years and 3 months to another 2-year term, because that would extend beyond the 8-year maximum. And in the last 10 years, we've never had anybody who did that. We had a city appointee, we had people who came in, like Art Granato has come in and filled unexpired terms, so it's always been kind of a hodgepodge in the last 10 years, but now we finally had the perfect storm with Dan Leyendecker, who was initially appointed to a full 2-year term in September, started serving in October, and so as a result, he would be termed out at 6 years and 3 months and would not be eligible. So as a result, you can amend your bylaws. You can't shorten anyone's current term of office under state law. So it would not be appropriate for us to say, okay, his current term is going to cut short in October, we'll have new elections this October, and rectify the matter. But the law does allow you to set the new board terms to go back to the October date. And you can do that between now and the January election, so that when you have the election of the board chair in January, the term of office will expire September 30th. And the current board chair and others similarly situated would be eligible in order to be reelected as board chair. I added part B because at the same time we changed the election of other officers to January of even numbered years. So if you want all of the officers to be elected at the same time, we can continue to do that by moving it all to October. But if you're the secretary or the vice chair, that doesn't change. You're still appointed by the city or the county or the mayor's panel, and so your term of office corresponds to your original term of office.
But that was back to my point, John. If you're elected secretary in January and you come up at 8 years in October, you can't be run as secretary, right?
Well, no. I mean, if you're secretary, your term of office will end. If you're a city appointee, it'll end in June of an even numbered year.
Yeah.
And if you're a county or mayor's panel appointee, it'll end in September. Completely unrelated to your term as an officer.
Okay, so at that time then you would re-elect a new secretary or vice chair?
Yeah, for example, we have a board secretary who's a city appointee. In June of an even numbered year, we would have a vacancy in the office of board secretary.
In July, we have to
appoint a new person to fill that office, because their term, if you're a city appointee and you become board chair, you will only be able to serve a maximum of 7.5 years, you know, just because of the off cycle between the appointments. So the staggered terms are always going to cut somebody short in one way or another. But with the county and mayor's panel and the way this came out, it comes out to be 6 years and 3 months, which is pretty short. Now, that was confusing. I tried to make it as simple as possible, but I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Yeah, any questions for John?
But it really, the board officers, their election could be in January, it could be in October. That is purely the prerogative of the board. It does not affect anyone's real term of office as a practical matter. It's just, when do you want to handle elections?
But I have a question. So this was done to accommodate the chair at the time? Because it was set up that way initially in September because of the terms, the way they expire?
Well, we had rocked along for a long time with the terms coming up in October. John Balls was the chair at the time. There was a thought this building would be finished by January and he could dedicate the building. It was not finished until a little bit later than that. And so, but that was part of the motivation to extend the term. But also a consideration was just to let all the board members have a little extra experience before they had a board election.
And this rule, did it affect, it was still in effect for the last three board chairs, but it didn't, with the way that their terms worked out, this rule, I guess they didn't ever had to like deal with it. Is that kind of the?
That's correct. For example, our last board chair, Edward Martinez, he was a city appointee, so it didn't really, his term was abbreviated by 6 months anyway, because it wasn't going to happen. Vanjie Chapa, another board chair in the interim, was a city appointee. It didn't really affect her. This is the first one that, you know, we had as a county appointee or a mayor's panel appointee that wound up getting cut to the 6 years and 3 months.
And I guess, yeah, that brings me to my second question is, I guess, why specifically now? Are we wanting to, because, I mean, I read through the board packet and it said the identified need, you know, obviously what was in there, you know, it looks like perhaps maybe from an equity standpoint, I think maybe what you're trying to get at, but I guess my question now is why are we doing this now?
Just in consideration of your next election of the board chair, whether you want to be able to reelect the current board chair or not. You would not be allowed to reelect the current board chair in January without this change.
Okay, so I guess, rather bluntly, is that the reason why we're bringing this forward now?
Correct.
Okay.
Just to have that choice. It's purely a board call in this matter. There's not a staff recommendation pro or con on this. This is purely a board decision.
Sure. My I guess, big issue with the time, I guess, with moving it back to October is we effectively limit city employees from becoming chair, right? So if we move it to October, they're only able to run in their third term for chair. I mean, they can run in their first or second term for chair, but most likely wouldn't get elected in their first or second term for chair. But let's take someone, my dear colleague to my right here, Mr. Salazar. You came in on July 2020, is that correct? First term? So 2020, so 2022 was your first term, July 2024 would be the end of your second term. At that point in time, he would have to run for chair in October of 25, or he wouldn't have enough time to run in his fourth term for chair. And if he ran for his third term in chair, he would effectively not be able to run for chair again in his fourth term.
Yes, city appointees, ever since 1985, when they become board chair, they only serve 7 years instead of eight, just because of the staggered terms that were set up between the initial creation in 1984 and the confirmation election in 85. So for the history of the RTA board, all city appointees who become board chair are limited to serving a maximum of 7 years. 7 years and 3 months, or 7 years and 6 months, you know, whether we have it in October or January, if that's the difference.
But county and small cities appointees would then have their full term. They could potentially run for two terms as chair because then they would have their full term.
That's correct.
We would be limiting city appointees from running for two terms as chair because we would effectively be terming them out in their fourth term, but allowing county and small city appointees to run for potentially two terms. Correct.
That's been the situation ever since the beginning in 1985. Yes, city appointees were limited to 7.5 years.
But the county and the small cities appointees were not limited at all.
Correct.
So essentially, if we're doing this for equity, we're making it very difficult for city appointees to become chair, and then effectively, if they don't become chair in their third term, we box them out from becoming chair in their fourth term. So essentially what we're doing is we're making it almost impossible for city appointees, not impossible, but we're making it very difficult for city appointees to hold the chair position. And obviously when a chair gets appointed, the appointing body from when that chair came from, whether it was the county, the city, the small cities, they're the ones who make the next appointment. So, and as a county appointee, this rule benefits me if I want to run for chair, right? And it benefits the county too, because now all of a sudden we have a better opportunity to get county appointees on. And then once the county person, that county person has a better opportunity to become chair, then we get another county appointee on. So essentially what this rule does, if we pass it today, is we pretty much limit the city of Corpus Christi's power and the city appointee's power on this board. And we're pretty much telling the mayor and the council that we're not interested in having any of your appointees in the chair spot.
That's really incorrect, Ms. Okay. Munoz. It's a misperception of the situation, because fundamentally under state law, city appointees are going to be limited to either 7.5 years or 7 years and 3 months, whichever way this amendment goes. That is, this amendment does not change that fact. They're going to be limited to either 7 years and 6 months or 7 years and 3 months. That's the reality.
That's correct.
And so that's the only thing that this amendment changes, is 7 years and 3 months to 7 years and 6 months.
But that's incorrect, because what it also changes.
That's in state law.
No, I understand that. But what this rule also changes is, currently county appointees, if they want to run for chair, I guess are limited to that 6 months or 6 years and 3 months. That's correct.
Yeah, currently it's 6 years and 3 months.
And if we change the rule today, that they would no longer be affected by that rule. Is that correct?
It would allow them to serve 8 years. Correct.
Correct. Okay, so that's my point, right? So this rule today, if we enact it, if we change the bylaws, is giving preference to county and small cities appointees, because it's giving them more eligibility than it is giving city appointees. Is that correct?
It's giving them more instead of a year and 3 months less.
But that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
The cities would be limited by whether
in January.
The cities would. I mean, we can agree that the city appointees would be limited, right? Because they would term out sometime, whether it's 7 years and 6 months, 7 years and 3 months.
Correct.
And the county appointees, if we change the rule, would not be limited at all.
Correct. Currently, the county and small city mayors' appointees are limited to 6 years and 3 months.
And so, in my opinion, the advantage then goes to the county and the small cities over the city of Corpus Christi, because then they have a better opportunity, because they would be limited in their fourth term, city appointees, from running for chair, that it gives the county the benefit, because we would have a better opportunity to elect a chair, and therefore have a better opportunity to put another county or another small city's appointee on the RTA.
That could be a perception, yes.
this thing was changed to accommodate a previous chair, not because for any other reason, number one. Number two, this board can change this for the next board chair. I think if we have a chair that we're comfortable with, Aaron, I think he should be allowed the full term. Whether it's you or whether it's me, it's gonna be up to the board to make that decision when it comes, because we can change the bylaws. It's in the bylaws that we can do that. So I don't see the issue. I think that our chair has done an excellent job, personally. And I think he deserves the opportunity, if he so chooses, to serve. And if it was Anna on the other side, and we had to accommodate her or Mr. Granado, who was vice chair for a day a week ago, they put a sign up there that he's a vice chair. He was wondering how he got promoted so quickly. But
I wondered when I missed that vote.
Yeah, I respect your opinion, Aaron, I really do. But I think that this body right here can make that accommodation, and whoever it was, and they wanted to serve out as much of a full term in their last term, I would certainly want this board to have that opportunity. It doesn't mean that he gets elected by this board, but it does mean he's allowed that opportunity. And by doing this, you restrict the opportunity from the current chair to do that.
Sure, would like to echo what Director Salazar has said. I feel like the board chair that we have has been incredibly engaged with direct contact on many, many, many occasions, ushered us through the CEO process. I didn't ever have that dialogue and contact with the previous board chair. And quite frankly, I take a little umbrage with the reasoning behind this, how it changed 10 years ago. So like Director Salazar mentioned, I think we've had an opportunity to experience Dan Leindecker as our board chair, and we can just make our decision based on that.
I do not feel comfortable voting today. I feel like I need more time to read through, and I need a timeline. I'm a very visual person. I need a timeline, and I would like to make my decision based on that.
I can appreciate, and I see Director Munoz's position. However, I am a city appointee, but when I sit on this board, I sit as a community appointee. Whether it be for the county or for the city, I'm making decisions that I believe are in the best interest as a whole. I'm an RTA board member. I know who I was appointed by, but my goal is to make the RTA the best it can be. Considering that, and considering the rule the way it's written, I echo Secretary Allison and Director Salazar. I think the way the rule and the reason it was written in the past should probably be amended to allow for our chairman to extend that his time so that he has an opportunity to fill the position. I agree with Lynn in that he's been very hands-on with us, and he's helped us, and he's done a great job. And I just think that cutting that term short when he's just basically getting started kind of puts us in a not necessarily the best position, and although I can see the position that Mr. Munoz takes, I think that it should be amended.
And I just want to make the comment, this has nothing to do with the current board chair. My opinion has nothing to do with the current board chair or your job. I think you've done a phenomenal job. My issue is I don't think we should be changing rules to give preferential treatment to some board members over the other, and what we're doing now is setting up to where the city appointees are at a disadvantage.
Would you be amenable to move it to July, to where it includes everybody?
I think if we table it right now, and if it's for equity purposes, so it can be the same for the city and the county.
Saying the same thing, I think.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. If we
with staggered terms, it could never be the same.
Right.
I mean,
or as close to equitable
terms
as possible.
So, if I could try one further time with staggered terms. It's either the most equitable would be if the two choices were 7 and 8, or 7.5 and 8. That's the closest to the same is 7.5 and 8, which is using the October date. By switching it to the January date, it changed it to 7 and 7.5 and 6 years and 3. So 6 years and 3 months in 7.5, there's a much greater disparity between the 6 years and 3 months for the county and small city mayors and the 7.5 for the city than there is between the 7 years and 3 months and 8 years, you know, disparity that you have when it's in October. So there's going to be a disparity regardless of how we do it because of the staggered terms, because of the difference between the, you know, the city and even numbered years in July and the others in October and September.
But we could we potentially even minimize that gap further between those 6 months, between 7.5 and 8, and come to, you know, some time period in between those two times? Because it's 3 and 3.
Well, I mean, if we go 1 month, the only way to make it closer would be to move the schedule from January to July, and that would be cutting it, that would make it then 8 years for city appointees, but it would make it less than 6 years for county and small city mayor appointees. So that would, that would create the disparity even more, that you'd have 6 years for one group and 8 years for the other group. The closest that we can get it is the 7 years and 3 months and the 8 years, that 9 month gap is the smallest gap that can be arranged between the two groups.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to make a motion that we move forward with item A and B, and then we can enter any other discussion that has to be had. That way we know where everybody stands.
And I second that motion.
I have a motion by Director Salazar, a second by Madam Secretary Lynn. Any further discussion, Ms. Chato? Mr. Granado?
I have a couple questions, I guess.
Yes,
maybe
sir.
Mr. Bell can answer this. You said, kind of go back of what somebody had pointed out, how this all first started, I guess, and why we changed it. Yeah, I can see how you would change it based on small cities and some of the county employees coming in. I mean, not county employees, but appointees. Maybe their first meeting, obviously you have to vote for a chair and trust.
I can
say I want to push it back to January, but somebody pointed out that it was specifically mentioned for one prior chair, and I'm trying to figure out the timeline on that. I mean, when do they actually break ground, I guess, on this building when that chair was here?
Well, a couple of years before. Okay. This project was, it took us quite a while to assemble the real estate and the groundbreaking. I mean, construction was about a year, so there were some delays and whatnot.
We'll say, like, I think it's September, maybe August of 2013. So the prior chair, which somebody said, Mr. Valls, I don't think he was here for the actual ribbon cutting of the building itself. I don't know if that's true or not, but I don't think that, was it changed just for him to basically?
No, he happened to be the chair that got the longer term. I just want to clarify that to make sure that's not the reason why. Yeah,
I mean, we can send away that, but just want to clarify that's not the reason why. I mean, obviously you're not going to put those in the minutes back in 2013 when they made those changes, but I can't see how they're just going to make the change for one particular person to actually dedicate a building that wasn't built when he left term in January. So if you can just kind of tell me exactly when it was broken and when those building was actually dedicated.
I don't have those dates. I have to go look on the plaque.
Okay, and fair enough. I just want to make sure we're not going to make it about one particular person and make it about a particular person when it comes this time also too. I mean, it has to be basically on the grounds of, and what we probably need to do so that we can figure this all out, and it should have probably been done years ago, is have basically the legislator kind of address these issues and kind of figure out a way so that we can figure out, so that we can maybe have a law change, so it's not going to be an issue down the road. So somebody doesn't go 6 years, somebody doesn't go 7.5. I mean, you get 8 years, and it needs to be somehow written in there. So if you have a year and a half left, that should be fair enough.
Well, with staggered terms, yeah, there's...
We have to just fix all of it if we have to do that. I mean, if that's something we want to do, if not, I understand. But, you know, I can see how this issue is probably going to come up again in 6 years, 8 years, and it's going to be back and forth of shortening, lengthening the terms, and, you know... Anyway, that's all I have. So I was just trying to, I just want to make sure that we're not saying that particularly that this board back in 2013 made a decision to go to January based upon one particular person. It's not going to be in the minutes. So I just want to make sure we don't put it on one person and no different than now.
I didn't mean to put it all on him. He was the board chair when it was done.
Okay. And just like, I don't see if we're going to shorten it. It's not just for Mr. Leindecker. It's obviously, as you stated earlier, based on the fact that people in your position down the road will be in the same predicament, and to me that is potentially an issue, because you shouldn't have to shortchange somebody just because of what appointment they're coming from, whether it's the county or whether it's the city. So I just want to clarify all that on my
end. Correct. This decision does have long-term implications in the equity that we're discussing, and it a significant number of board members are initially appointed to fill an unexpired term, like Mr. Granado, at least probably somewhere between 10 and 20% in the history of the RTA. And so that's going to be offset anyway, because when you come in to fill an unexpired term, those years count, and the state law is quoted as a maximum of just 8 years flat. Doesn't make any difference if So, for example, if you're a city appointee and you came in to fill an unexpired term a year after the fact, like Mr. Granato has. The most he can serve is 7 years, period. You know, well, although, in fact, if he became board chair at some point, he would be, you know, cut out from that, because just that's the way the calendar works. You can't be appointed to a term that extends you beyond that hard 8-year cap. I can tell you that in 2013, the board did not consider this equity issue of what the impact it had on county and mayor panel folks. This discussion did not occur, and it is a very valid discussion for you to have. All I'm saying is that the disparity is either going to be a disparity between 8 years and 7 years and 3 months, which is the closest we can get, or a disparity between 7.5 years and 6 years and 3 months. That's the, you know, so there's going to be a disparity one way or the other. It's just pick which one you think is more equitable.
John, and to clarify that, I'm sorry, to clarify that, if we move it to October, it would be the 7.5 and 8 year term?
Correct.
And if we keep it in January, it's going to be the
seven and a half and 6 years and 3 months. Okay.
If I could just expand upon Director Granato's comments, to be clear, at this time, the legislature has given us the authority to make this amendment. That being said, we are kind of walking a thin line between looking back at what a previous board chair did versus what we're faced with right now, and you just took the oath of office to protect and preserve this agency, which right now I see that in the long-term implications as the status quo of our existing board chair. We can't undo the past, and we can't control the future. So we have the ability as a board to make this amendment or turn or reverse this amendment that was made 10 years ago, if you will. So that's all I have.
I got a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
Yeah, Chairman, this is Director Coleman. For Mr. Bell, with this passes, when will we have elections? I just need clarification on that.
I couldn't hear Director Coleman.
I couldn't make out the question exactly. If it passes, what is the question?
If this passes, when will we hold the elections for the chair position? I just want to get clear on that.
The election would be held in January. And okay. It would be for a term expiring September 30th, with the new election of the board chair to be, the next election of a board chair to be in October of 2025. So our next two board chair elections would be January of 24 and October of 25.
Okay.
Director Chottle, can you repeat your comment or your question?
My question was, if we moved it back to its original October date, from 1985, what I understand, it was from 1985, the October date, the time period would be the 7.5, or the years would be 7.5 and 8 years, or 7 and 3 months and 8 years?
Yes, 7 years and 3 months and eight.
7.3 yeah. And 8 years, but if we left it in January, it would now be 7.5 and 6 years?
And it would be 7.5 and 6 years and 3 months.
6.3, okay. So essentially creating a greater disparity if we left it in January for the board members.
I have a comment.
But just to clarify though, but if a city appointee wanted to run, for example, in 2025 and they termed out in 2028 and that person was elected board chair in 2025.
Correct.
They would not be eligible to run again in 2027 if they term out July 2028.
That is correct.
Okay, but every county or small cities appointee would be able to run for re-election if they so choose.
Well, as board chair, everyone who was elected in these, who was first appointed in September, those who come in after the fact to fill unexpired terms, then are limited based upon the.
But absent the 10% or the 20% of the people that come on unexpired terms, the county and the small cities appointees would not be limited for would not be prohibited from running for a second term as chair, but
they could serve a full 8 years, no question about that.
But a city appointee that is put on in July would be prohibited, if they were chair in their third term, would be prohibited from being chair in their fourth term.
That is correct.
I want to make a comment. This is Director Gonzalez.
Yeah, that is going to be the case. If it's an election in October of odd years or January of even years, the difference is only 3 months. But the city council members still would not be able to be appointed to a second term because the expiration would still, you know, would run it long, but you know they couldn't go there.
But Jay, just to clarify, those city appointees would be prohibited from running for a fourth term or for a second term as chair.
Either way we do it, whether it's in January or October.
Okay, but in Jan. Okay, I got you.
I do agree with Director Granado. I mean, I don't know what the ramifications are with bringing it up to the legislature to make it inequitable because of the staggered term, but it might be something we want to look at for the next legislative session.
I think so too, because we're only really affected by this rule because there aren't 3,000 people that live in this city, right? Because the limit is for 320,000 people, right? There's a gap, right? Over 1.9 million or under 320,000. That this rule applies to?
Well, this rule initially applied to three transit authorities. It applied to us and Austin and San Antonio. And then Austin was carved out, quite frankly, because a high-ranking official of Dell Computers was the board chair. And Capital Metro, and he did a lot in turning around Capital Metro, and it had been a punching bag of the legislature for quite a while. So he was well respected in the legislature. And so they changed the term limit in Austin to extend it for a couple years for this board chair to negotiate. Now we could, quite frankly, the issues that created the term limit in the first place probably no longer exist. And yeah, I don't see it as a big issue to change it to where there's 8 or 9 years, or we could come up. Our consultant is here with us. It would be, could either go on local and consent or, you know, it could be a bracket bill for Corpus Christi that takes care of this 1 year inequity, but because of the staggered terms to where it's, I'll call it más o menos 8.
Yeah, más o menos 8. Director Gonzalez has been trying to get on for a minute.
It would be a más o menos 8 that would say, you know, you can do it as long as it don't go beyond 9.
Director Gonzalez, you were trying to say something earlier. You have the floor, sir.
Thank you. I apologize. I just got off of Zoom a few minutes ago, but I had researched the agenda item prior to the hearing. I see both sides. I see Director Munoz's opinion. I see everybody. My main concern is I think it shouldn't have been changed in the first place. And it kind of reminds me of when I first got on the board and there were certain issues that some people didn't want us to vote on. And I think that just comes with the territory. You can't be moving deadlines back or forward just because of certain things that come up when somebody gets into their term. Those are just, that's why you're appointed. Those are your responsibilities, whether you know the person well enough or not. That is beside the point. And I believe Mr. Bell kind of mentioned that was one of the reasons that was discussed during the time of the move to January. So that in itself, I think, personally, I feel it needs to be rectified. You know, it needs to be as equitable as possible. And if equity means moving back to October and there's ancillary benefits with certain people on the board now are able to run again, I mean, to me, that just, it is what it is, you know? And I personally feel that we got to get as close to equity as possible. Obviously, it seems like there's nothing that's exactly perfect, and I guess the legislature would be the only people to try to rectify that problem. But my opinion is regardless of why it was changed in the first place, I don't want to speculate as to rumors or whatnot, but it probably shouldn't have been. And we've been working this way, but it never hurts to try to rectify things that maybe after years of dealing with it, you know, we realize that it shouldn't have been done in the first place. And I think as leaders, we need to be able to accept that fact that sometimes we just got to correct some mistakes that were made. And that's kind of how I feel about the situation.
Mr. Chair, if I could clarify something.
Yes, please.
And I apologize for this, but in Mr. Munoz's illustration, and it was something was not adding up, and I just realized the problem. For the city appointee can be elected for two terms as chair after you serving two terms as a city appointee. In fact, that has been the case throughout the 35-year history of this board. The issue is solely that last term is either going to be a 1 year and 3 month term or a 1 year and 6 month term. For the first 28 years, it was a 1 year and 3 month term. Pat Eisenhower, being the first board chair, wound up her fourth term was only 1 year and 1 year and 3 months because of the October elections. When we extended it, then Eddie Martinez's term and other city Vanjie Chapa's term became, you know, her fourth term was 1 year and 6 months. So it's always been the case that city appointees could be appointed to four terms, two by the city and two by the board, for example, in the illustration you were talking about. The sole issue is being that that last term has been cut short because the board chair's term expired in October of odd numbered years rather than go around. And so this is not a situation that a city appointee could not be appointed to that second term as board chair if they had been appointed to two previous terms by the city council. It's just a function of will that fourth term that they serve be a term of a year and 3 months, which was the way it was initially, or a year and 6 months, which was the way it's been the last 10 years. But that last term was always abbreviated, but there was the ability to reelect the city appointee to a fourth term.
Why doesn't that rule apply in this situation? Why couldn't we reelect our chair in January and then just have him serve out the rest of his time?
Well, because it's simply the calendar and the math and the way the state law works, because he was appointed in, his term of office began in October, and he can't serve beyond October 2nd of 2025.
But why, are city appointees allowed to serve beyond?
No, that's what I'm saying. City appointees, it's never been an issue with city appointees because when they become the board chair, their fourth term is cut short to either a year and 3 months as it was originally or a year and 6 months. For the county and mayor's panel appointees, for them to serve, their last term would then in effect be 2 years and 3 months. And the legislature put in a very hard and fast 8-year limit that you cannot be appointed to a term that would extend beyond 8 years from your initial appointment. And so the problem is created for the county and mayor's panel. Since they can't go 3 extra months, we have to cut them off and they can only serve 6 years and 3 months as a result.
So by state law, city appointees are allowed to serve beyond 8 years. City appointees are allowed to serve beyond 8 years or be elected to a term that would take them?
No, as I tried to explain, city appointees will either serve 7 years and 3 months based upon the original set with October elections, or 7 years and 6 months based upon the May election. And that's been the way it's been for the history of the RTA since 1985. The city appointees who became board chair either served 7 years and 3 months or 7 years and 6 months with this more recent change. But nobody can serve beyond eight.
So, so then would a city appointee who, you know, terms out in 2028, July 2028, would they be able to run for chair in October of 2027?
If they, no, that would actually extend them to a 9 years and 3 months. And they're limited by eight.
Okay.
So, I mean, you know, they couldn't be elected for a fifth term. That would be their fifth term.
2020. Now, 2020 to 2022. That's one. 2022 to 2024. 2024 to 2026. If they're elected in 2027, their fourth term would be from 2026 to 2028. So, if they were reappointed in 2026, they would be prohibited from running for chair in 2027.
Because that 2026 appointment would be their fourth appointment.
Okay.
Already. So they've been appointed four times, and their last time is just going to be a 1 year and 3 month term. But they've been appointed four times.
And if they were elected in 2025, they wouldn't be eligible for re-election in 2027.
Well, because that would be extending them to 9 years and three months.
All right, got it.
Any other discussion? I'd like to recognize John Valls, our former chairman. You'd like to have a few words?
Yes.
Welcome, John.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody.
And just for the record, we went and looked this up. John was here in 2013 for the ribbon cutting, groundbreaking.
Yeah.
And Curtis Rock was the chairman, when they finished the building 3 years later in 2016.
Right, correct.
I just want to clear the record on that, John.
Yeah, I apologize for that.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yes, thank you, members of the board. I got a phone call. Hey, you better get down there. They're talking about you. I said, oh, here we go. RTA again, a monkey on my back, because I hear that Mr. Bell said that the rule was changed so that I could dedicate the building in January. Well, that's not true.
Yeah.
We had the groundbreaking of September of 13th. I still remember all this, John. We had the groundbreaking of September 13th, and I left in January of 2014. So that's not true, because if I don't clarify that, somebody will take it out in the public, and oh, my God, right. Here we are. So the reason behind that was because the small city, there was always inequity, but the small city appointments, two, and the county appointments, three, are appointed in typically September. They take office in October. What was happening was that some of those members were forced to elect a chair and officers at their very first meeting, and they weren't comfortable with that. So we said, well, let's just move it a couple of months to get them comfortable with who the candidates are, get to know the board members, get to know the process. So that's why we did it. The thinking was that, okay, it's going to create an oddball time, and eventually somebody's going to get caught up with this scenario, which is what you're facing today. But our thinking was back then was that, okay, we can get it corrected legislatively. Let's take a bill to the legislature, or y'all take a bill to the legislature sometime down the road to add one more year. So to make the term limits a maximum of 9 years, that would have cleaned it up. But it's been 10 years, and that has not happened in the legislature. So that's what the thinking was. It wasn't to dedicate a building so somebody could, you know, have all the pomp and circumstance. No, it was to assist those county and small city appointees from ever having to be faced with their first meeting, which was happening, electing a chair and electing officers. That's why. That's it. So, but like I said, the thinking was it would get cleaned up in the legislature eventually, but it's been 10 years and you've had a few legislative sessions since then and it hasn't been cleaned up. But that's really the easy fix, is just to get it cleaned up in the legislature, because there's always going to be inequity one way or another. So I appreciate it, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to educate the board and let the board know what was going on way back then and what our thought process was.
Thank you for the history lesson, Mr. Boss.
You got it. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you, sir. All right. Any other discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for the vote. I guess we need to do a poll, or how do we call that?
It requires six votes to pass.
Six votes to pass. Okay, and we have two online. We got Mr. Gonzalez.
In order for the two online to vote, we would need to see their faces.
Jeremy, we got to see your face, bud, if you want to have your vote count. Marisa, will you call the roll of the vote, please?
Five,
restate the motion?
Gabby Canales?
I vote yes.
Beatrice Chottle?
Yes.
Jeremy Coleman? Armando Gonzalez?
Yes.
Arthur Granado?
Yes.
Aaron Munoz?
No. No.
Eloy Salasad?
Yes.
Motion passes. All right, thank you very much. Thanks for the spirited debate. Mr. Valls, thank you very much for coming down and clearing all the history up. We really appreciate that, sir.
Yeah.
And we'll try to get this fixed in the legislature this next round.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely.
Yes, sir.
There's always going to be inequity. But thank you, guys. I appreciate it.
But thank you for coming down. I know you're a very busy man. And
hey, yeah, Josh, luckily our office down
Don,
the street.
Don, you did get to be here for the ribbon cutting, though. Yes or no?
No, I was not on the board for the ribbon cutting.
No, I'm talking about when they, not the ribbon cutting, but when they opened
broke
the
ground in 2013.
The groundbreaking?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was the chairman. Yeah.
No, but when the building was
dedicated?
There you go.
Well, every former board chair was invited, and I was invited.
Well, congratulations.
Yeah, well, you enjoy the benefits of that today in this beautiful building. So, all right, thank you guys.
We appreciate it.
Did that help? Okay, good.
Yeah, I did. We cleared your name. All right, thank you.
No, I cleared my name. I appreciate it.
Well, we did too. Thank you, John. Bye-bye.
Hey, thanks, John.
Bye, John.
Appreciate it. All right. All right, let's go to, that was agenda item 12. Let's go to agenda item 13, committee chair reports. Admin and finance, Ms. Canales.
I do not have a committee chair report.
Director Salasad for operations and capital projects.
Nothing at this time other than congratulations to our staff on the two new bus stops. They look great, and look forward to the other one that's under construction on Ayers. Good job, staff. Mike.
Thank you, sir. In our rural and small cities, Madam Secretary.
Nothing new, sir.
Thank you. Legislative, Director Munoz.
Only update is I'm working on setting up meetings for Coastal Bend Days with some FTA representatives. One of the things that I learned from our esteemed our consultant over here is you can't keep going up to places just asking for things. You got to show your face around sometimes and ask them what they're interested in, what some of their initiatives that we can be promoting. And so the purpose of these FTA meetings is to kind of get some face time with their leadership so we can. Some of the issues that we'll be discussing, obviously, is ridership. We won't be, obviously, talking about EVs or anything like that, given our pending application. But we're going to really just be asking them what the FTA is looking for in the future. I know one of the things that they're going to be up and coming on is rural and urban connectivity, which I think we're a perfect agency to kind of talk about that and talk about kind of the things that we're doing. And have them give us some feedback on what it is, how we can kind of bolster that and then do some of the things that maybe the FTA is looking for as well. So, once I have those meetings set up with myself, the CEO, and I believe our deputy CEO will be in those meetings too. And if there's anybody else that's gonna be attending Coastal Bend Days, let me know if you would like to attend. I can definitely put your name so you can go attend those meetings as well. But I'll give you an update, and then obviously once we have our meetings, I'll come back and give some updates on the conversations that we had with the FTA.
Great. Thank you, sir. All right. Update on the state legislative report by Longbow Partners. Trish, you didn't know you were going to be here this long, did you?
Good morning. we have Trish Castaneda doing the update on what happened this session.
Good morning, Tris.
Good morning. Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here with everyone again today. I've got a whopping 3 minutes, so I will speed through this presentation and invite anyone for questions. I wanted to provide an overview, sharing some of the basic data that occurred during this past session, some of the overarching issues, and then delve into transit-specific and RTA specific agendas of the adopted program. I think the previous conversation you've had that has never been part of our adopted program, but certainly as these issues arise, those can be easily incorporated, particularly now as we're in the interim, and then open up for questions. I think everyone knows that the legislature convened as it typically does in the odd numbered years. There is, technology, way to go. Thank you. This was a unique session. It was following a big redistricting, which usually translates to a whole bunch of new members coming in. There were five in the Senate, which is pretty substantial. The number of new members in the House is about average. I mean, they average somewhere between 17 and mid-20s after a redistricting. This is also a unique session in that there was an unprecedented $33 billion surplus. And as you can imagine, there are 1,000 ideas on how to spend that money. And when those ideas compete against each other, that tends to suck up a lot of oxygen. Same time, there were a number of sunset bills dealing with the electric grid, TCEQ, all the permitting associated with that, the Texas Water Development Board, which operates some substantial grant and low interest loan programs. And so those are items that tended, again, to suck up a lot of oxygen out of the limited 140-day, 140 nights. And so you would think with that big surplus and all the big three aligning on property tax reform that that would be a no-brainer. That did not pass. It took two special sessions, the details of which I will get into in just a few here. But there still remains issues like border security, school choice or vouchers, which has not been resolved, and there's anticipated to be another upcoming session in October. They said late September, but I think I've learned more, and it looks like it'll be early October when those come in. It was important for property tax reform, which is why the governor called people back for the special two times immediately, because those ballots needed to be printed in order to be eligible for the November 7 election. Interestingly, embedded in all the number of new spending programs, all of those things fall outside of the constitutional spending cap. So when the voters approve this, they're approving money above and beyond the constitutional spending limit. The only other thing I would say is that we saw an unprecedented amount of bills, more than the last, more than any session, really. There were 8,580 bills filed. Roughly 15% made their way all the way to the governor's desk. The governor fell just one short of the number of maximum vetoes. He vetoed 76 bills this go around and a couple of line item issues. So roughly, if you look at this session, there's about 14% that actually end up becoming law. Normally, you'd see at least another 54 to 60 bills reach the governor's desk. One of the big topics I'm sure you all have been following is the property tax package. There's some details in here about specifically what provisions are in there, should they be approved by the voters. It's hard to imagine that they would not approve that, but you'll see some school tax compression, increase of the homestead exemption from 40,000 to 100,000. There will be a temporary appraisal cap designed to help those that do not own homes, but that will, of course, sunset. Some franchise tax exemptions and a new addition to county appraisal districts would be the elected appraisal districts. I want to point to a couple of other big issues before we get into the specifics for transit and the RTA. One highlight is House Bill 2127, otherwise known as the MOAP, or the mother of all preemptions, or known as the Death Star. There 74 co-authors and joint authors on that bill. That bill did pass. Houston, San Antonio, and Dallas are challenging the enactment of that bill. And essentially what that would do is it would take all non-uniform city and county regulations and a variety of different codes and preempt them with a standard so that it could be applied evenly across the board. The other one I'd highlight is Senate Bill 739, which is the sales tax exemption for diapers, feminine hygiene products, and baby wipes. That is expected to have a fiscal note to the state through 2025 of $226.7 million. Every political subdivision will be affected by that, provided that they receive revenue through the sales tax. As you know, when we started this process back in March of 2021 and then again in November of 2021, the board put together a legislative package. And back then we talked about the things that we knew were going to be predictable and, you know, like the passing of a budget, the sunset bills, et cetera, and that there were going to be some things that are going to happen that are unique to every session. There's not only new members, you get new committee assignments. Coastal Bend did fantastic, got a lot of very important positions filled, but there's also the cooperation and compatibility among leadership. Interestingly, this go around, the big three who usually meet for a weekly breakfast, that did not happen this session. And you could see the communication challenges that were occurring between the various bodies. You look at the governor's emergency items, the speaker's emergency items, and the lieutenant governor's emergency items, and you could see a little Venn diagram where they all fit together, but there were a whole bunch of other circles that did not overlap, and we saw that play out during the session. Because the RTA is a political subdivision, there are a ton of things that don't hit 451 nor 452 that have an effect on your operations, whether it's financial, whether it's operational. And of those, we tracked 211 bills. Four were suggesting amendments to 451, six were in 452, and 45 did not touch those chapters but made references to regional, mass, rapid, metropolitan, or rural transit. Fortunately, there was no negative legislation that affected you all outside of perhaps whatever loss there is on the sales tax for feminine products, baby wipes, and diapers. This was an active session for us. I want to thank Chairman Leindecker, the legislative chair, Munoz, Secretary Lynn Allison, Eloy Salazar, and Commissioner Canales. Thank you for that. Y'all have spoken to me on the phone. We've communicated through text or emails, and I appreciate everybody making time to come up to Austin. I think we are enhancing our presence. I feel confident that everybody in the delegation now knows our specific legislative desires, but all of that could not have happened, of course, without the support of Mike Rendon and his team, including John Bell, whose drafting skills and prowess was on full display, particularly as we started to identify vehicles to amend to try to advance our initiatives. Obviously, we are the outside actors. The only people that vote are the elected members. Hats off to our delegation, both collectively and individually. Senator Hinojosa, Senator La Mantilla, Chairman Hunter, Herrero, J.M. Lozano, and of course our extended delegation members from Hidalgo, Chairman Canales, and from Montgomery County, Chairman Robert Nichols, who helped us when they were passing the electric vehicle fee, so they exempted us from having that applied to our bus fleet. Without the delegation, we would not have been as successful. I'm pleased again to work with you all during this session. And then as we move to the specific adopted agenda, you can see here those items that are enumerated. You'll see that the bill numbers associated with the side, the being able to share during times of emergency or extended circumstances, other political subdivisions to be able to use our alternative fueling facilities. That did not pass. We did get through HB1, the clean air planning dollars, the TERP program. There were a couple of bills that were filed in there that did pass, that did no harm to us in terms of our eligibility for those programs. TxDOT Sunset was listed in here, but they're not up till 2029. However, the governor's trustee programs for economic development, things that are beneficial to the Coastal Bend, Water Development Board, and TCEQ, those were all passed. And then the federal dollars for infrastructure that are being handed down to the state, those weren't an active issue at the time. So the legislature did not act on that. They had a ton of surplus, no reason to delve into those federal dollars yet, but that will be coming down the pike. Herein lies the one that I know is very important. This is the first time we've always mentioned this as being a possibility, but the Fair Approval Committee modifying that so that it mirrors the way that Cap Metro in Austin is treated. That did not pass. We looked at various amendments and ran those aground. Unfortunately, that did not pass either. The criminal offense for protecting our employees who face a number of different challenges when they are working, the enhanced penalties there also did not pass. The local 2-cent sales cap issue, it's a good idea, something that people talked about, but there was no legislation filed, so obviously that did not pass. And the same thing about exempt, since we're exempt from alternatively fueled vehicles, we were looking to expand that exemption both to diesel and to regular gasoline. No bill on that was filed either, and so that obviously did not pass. Moving on to the endorsements, to expand I'm just trying to roll through on 3 minutes here, and I know I'm way over, I apologize. There was no legislation passed, so that did not pass in terms of an endorsement. There was several bills passed that would provide funding for flood infrastructure. Those bills are enumerated there, that did pass. And then again, the federal funding is an ongoing issue. That is not something that the legislature chose to address, but they'll have those dollars available. And then lastly, on the defensive side, there were bills that would have undermined not only the competitive bidding approach, your ability to go out and get bonds, those bills are elected there. There's a withdrawal bill that's listed in item number one, also that did not pass. The funding sources for streets, there was no bill filed, so that did not pass. The preservation of the governance structure, something that you all had been talking about extensively here, no bill filed, that did not pass. The regulatory advocacy or the prohibition of a political subdivision from hiring a government relations professional, there were a number of bills filed there, those did not pass. Same thing on the makeup or size of the board, that did not pass. The withdrawal, It's listed there. That bill failed. There was a bill that would have affected the RTA's ability to use design build or P3, and that bill did not pass, but it didn't do any injury to what you currently have in place. It would have been an enhancement had it passed. And then the alternative fueled vehicle road user fees, again, I mentioned that previously, where Chairman Canales and Chairman Nichols were helpful to us, as they were last session, and they used the 10,000 gross weight criteria. So all in all, there were 21 items in the package. 13 passed or were defeated, which is a 61% pass rate. While I had higher expectations for one of the more important items that we had, we'll be back at it, and I think that there is a lot of leverageable opportunities that every time we engage, there's always something that can be learned and something that can be improved on by way of processes. That is it. I know I went over the 3 minutes. I tried to go through it relatively quickly, and happy to answer any questions. Yes, sir.
A couple of things. It was brought up about trying to move the term. I can see the benefit of going to night to allow the board, any appointed board, to serve more than 8 years to fix this problem that we've had. Is it possible to try to bring that up, and maybe our legislative chair can look into it to see if it's a possibility? At least, aren't they having another session, or they're done? Question.
They'll have another one, but it's going to be subject to a limited call. Okay. It is possible that the governor may throw school choice out there and then say, if you guys go along with this, we might open up the call, but to expect that they'll open it up for public transit, I think, is probably a bit of a stretch. I mean,
as much as the healthy debate that we had, I think it's an important issue to at least look at, because I can see the problems that we're encountering. For me, I like to see a board chair serve, especially if I think he's doing a good job, to serve out the second term, and it became a challenge for him. And we're not doing it for him. I think we're doing it for the principal. If it came up again, and Aaron had that same issue, I would support it as well if he was.
I think that's an excellent point. You can look at it multiple ways. Is it just specific for Corpus? Should it apply across the board, where we can work with the other large transit authorities under 451?
The city appointees, because I was on the Planning Commission, and if you serve an unexpired term, you get to serve the extra year or year and a half.
Right.
So it's the city has it set up that way. Second question, on the appraisal district appointees, is that going to be looped into the property tax bill? Is it going to be one lump sum bill, or is it going to be line itemed?
It'll be included in the final package.
So it's going to be one. It's going to be just one check mark for all four.
That is correct.
The property tax, and then the commercial properties at 20%.
Comes as a full package.
So it's going to pass then. Okay.
I think it'd be hard to imagine that the public wouldn't think they're not being taxed enough.
I was on the appraisal district board for 8 years, so I can see what they're trying to accomplish to get additional appointees. So okay, so it is going to be grouped in.
Yes,
the other ones. Okay.
And they drew the ballot placement. You'll see something in our monthly newsletter that'll come out
nice
and share with
separate,
you on those.
But they have them all together so that the Homestead is going to push the commercial stuff. Not everybody wants the commercial stuff, because, and especially the refineries that were at $1 billion, and now they're at $6 billion, and now they negotiated, I think, $2.5 billion and $2 billion or something. Or not negotiated. The appraisal district revised their numbers. They still have to fight with the refineries, I guess, is my understanding.
That is correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Any other questions for Tris?
Question.
Yes, Madam Secretary, please.
Thank you very much. Can you please make this, Tris and Derek, available, this presentation? I don't see it in our Dropbox later today.
Sure.
The comments that I have are some headwind was made. We need to start now for the next 2 years. We need to be able to pivot with the political headwinds. Despite our best efforts, it got the best of us, and I want to remain active on this committee. And also, when you, Aaron, directed at you, move forward with these FTA events, and with regard to the input from small cities, please keep me in the loop on that. We have a lot that we need to accomplish, and we're making great headway, but we need to do better, and support you in that effort, and really just ask that you stay engaged and strategic in how we approach the session in 2 years from now.
Yeah, I would like to add that our legislature said just maybe email us when you're going to have some kind of a committee meeting, because we really haven't had one, other than you're making us aware and you're doing a great job of keeping us informed, but this way the committee can be a little bit more engaged and help you.
That's a great point. Early filing will be in November. I mean, one of the things that, you know, whenever you are going to advance something like the fare box, we wanted to make sure that all the local governments were informed. That's the last thing we needed, was to drop something in there without that. Ledge Council lost a lot of talent. It took forever to get bills out, and so I agree 100%. I think your comments are well taken.
Any other questions for Tris?
I just want to just to kind of echo Director Salazar's comments about, you know, the legislature seeing if and kind of Director Granado's recommendation, seeing how we can change the term limit thing, whether by expanding it to 9 years, or even if we, you know, I don't know if the city is statutorily obligated to have their appointments in July, or if we could find a way to get the city to move theirs to October, and then that way we kind of eliminate this whole controversy in general, and then that way everybody, both, you know, city, county, small cities, all come on board at the same time, and we have our elections, whether in, you know, October or however, and like, maybe we try that avenue first, and if that doesn't work, you know, maybe we can, you know, put something together for that, so we could start looking at that at the state level. But no, I just want to also thank, you know, the chairman, Chairman Leyendecker, and Secretary Salasad. I mean, excuse me, Secretary Allison. I know, right? Secretary Allison.
What's that vote too? We have a vice chairman over here.
Yeah,
and
right.
Secretary over here.
I got the opportunity to go up to Austin with y'all and talk directly to some legislators. Unfortunately, I know Director Salazar and Director Canales were up there as well. I wasn't with you on those trips, but I know y'all worked hard for this. You know, for the vote, for those of you that do have the pleasure to walk the Capitol with Tris, it's like being with a rock star, honestly. You know, you got legislators and all, hey, Tris, what's going on? Giving them hugs, and I'm like, man, how does he know all these people? But, and you know, just working with you over the last session, like I said, tremendously learned a lot from you, and look forward to continuing to work with you in the future. And if there are things that we can be doing, kind of like what I said before, you know, just so we're not showing up all the time with our hands out, you know, and kind of getting in front of some of these people and letting them know that we're invested and we're willing to help them too. You know, if there are things that we can be doing like that, please let us know.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Any other questions for Tris? Anybody online have any questions for Tris?
I just have a
Tris.
Comment.
Pardon me?
I have a comment.
Yes, sir.
I just want to say, Tris, you did a really good job. Somebody who's up there in Austin during the session, I'm up there quite a lot. I just want to say that I know that Secretary Lynn Allison was up there. I saw her, so I'm the chairman up there. I saw Aaron up there. So I want to say that, you know, that's what you really want from your board here, is to really be engaged when it comes to, you know, the issues that they really want. And, you know, I think Ms. Canales said it too, best. I mean, they're going to start filing bills relatively soon. You know, of course, it's November of next year, but, you know, they're already going to have issues they're going to start running on. And I think it's important that, you know, this board itself, whatever it needs to get done, needs to start working on that now, because, I mean, there are circumstances, and you probably would have had it. I think this board would have had a lot more wins, but there are some circumstances just beyond our control that we couldn't do anything about, just the way it plays out. It's politics. The governor has issues with certain people, and it is what it is. And I'll leave it at that, but I think you did a great job. You were always up
there.
I mean, I was in Austin at least 3 times a week, and I have a condo up there, and you're always in that Capitol grounds working, I think, in the best interest of your clients, in particular the RTA. So I want to say you did a good job, and 60%, you know, I think that's good. But I think we also need to, whatever issues we're going to look at, I think we have a good board here to be able to get that accomplished, especially with you being there for us. So I just want to thank you for all the service you've done.
Thank you, Director Granado.
Any other questions for Tris?
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I want to say thank you very much. He also knows all the secret passageways and how to get around the Capitol, the shortcuts. We really appreciate all your help.
You can get your steps in that way, right?
I know we kept running around, but, you know, you did a damn fine job, and we appreciate it.
Support of the board is absolutely critical, just like that of the delegation. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to represent you all.
Yeah, thank you, Tris.
Thank you.
All right, agenda item 15, presentation on the 2022 annual report for the Coastal Bend Air Quality Partnership.
So we have Ms. Sharon Bailey Murphy here that's going to present the annual report, as well as Mrs. Gretchen Arnold, who used to present that report in previous years.
I was going to do the same, but I'll wait till we're both.
Good morning. I'll be introducing Sharon in a moment, along with the presentation that she'll be bringing forward to you. I am here as actually a little bit of a history briefer, like we enjoyed earlier with this meeting, on the Coastal Bend Air Quality Partnership, where we've come from, our past relationship with RTA, and where we are going. And I think you'll be quite impressed with where we've been and what you'll see before you with the 2022 annual report that will be presented by Sharon. Back in the day, we were the Corpus Christi Air Quality Group, and we approached RTA, I'm going to say it's been at least 10 years ago, to be a preliminary stakeholder in funding this particular group that was the sole purpose of keeping an eye on where our airshed is with ozone air quality attainment basis based on federal standards, what we can do voluntarily to remain within federal standards for ozone, and keep our airshed in attainment of standards for ozone. The stakeholders that we had that funded the group was RTA, City of Corpus Christi, Nueces County, the Port of Corpus Christi, and the MPO. And each stakeholder committed to a $5,000 annual contribution for this group to do their research, to recommend programs, to implement voluntary emission reduction programs in our airshed, and do our very best to make sure that our airshed stayed within attainment of ozone standards. I was with Texas A&M University's Pollution Prevention Partnership at the time, and running the group developing the programs was a great fit to what I did in the community. I retired from A&M, though, and it was important that the air quality group continue. So it was basically run out of my kitchen, this big group that's very important to the community. Was me and my dog for the executive assistant, and we knew that that was just not sustainable. This was not where our community needed to come from and grow, do the growth that is needed, and continue to maintain standards for air quality. Remain in attainment. Attainment is going to be an important word I'm going to share with you a couple of times as it applies back to RTA. So over time, we have actually grown into a full-time, with a full-time executive director in an office organization established, and with a board of directors. Our challenges have become more and more challenging over the years with industrial growth, with a lot more vehicles on the road. All of the emissions that create ozone have grown exponentially over the last 10 years. In addition to being concerned about ozone, EPA is also now requiring us to keep our eye much more closely on particulate matter, or PM. So again, our challenge as an organization that seeks to keep us in attainment of air quality standards has grown. Our stakeholder partnership contributions have grown during that time as well, recognizing that we are now a full-time organization with huge responsibilities, and $5,000 annual contributions are not significant enough to keep this organization going. And we've been able to enjoy increases in the stakeholder commitments from Nueces County, from the City of Corpus Christi, from the port, from their initial contributions of $5,000 annually to $90,000 annually, $25,000 annually. And this is something where I felt like it was important to me to come back before the board as I've stepped down, as we've grown into this full-time organization with a full-time executive director, to remind the board of the relationship that we've had in the past with RTA. we've approached our TA requesting an increase in your annual contribution. We have three-year extendable agreements with our stakeholders. RTA is concluding its final third year on its current agreement with the Air Quality Partnership of $5,000 a year. And I'm here to request that RTA consider increasing that annual contribution to $15,000 a year. It's renewable yearly based on funding being made available to the organization to be able to do that. Before I step down and introduce our new organization and our new director, I want to remind this board about how important the word attainment is, and I'm sure your legislative representatives here can echo the fact that once you are a community that moves from attaining air quality standards to no longer attaining air quality standards, the burden of you seeing success in legislative issues that fund your organization is increased exponentially. The burden of your planning department here is increased exponentially because now their plan here for your organization is burdened with being a non-attainment community and all of the additional activities and planning efforts that they're going to have to go through. So you'll need to bring in more staff. You'll need to be burdening your staff with compliance and getting back into attainment planning that you've never had to deal with before. You rely heavily on federal funding for your funding. Once you move into a non-attainment community, federal funding is far more difficult to achieve. It's far more difficult to apply for. So your burden as a transportation organization is increased hugely once you move into the world of no longer attaining air quality standards. So this organization is very important to your organization. Their success is your success. Your success is our community's success. And I implore this board to please consider adjusting the annual contributions to this group from $5,000 a year to $15,000 a year. So without further ado, I know that your board meeting is running late. I do want to introduce our first and new full-time executive director, Sharon Bailey Murphy, and she will provide to you our new organization and what we accomplished in 2022. Thank you all very much.
Thank you so much, Gretchen. I know most of you know her. I am completely honored to stand here before you today. This is my first time, so it was quite a meeting.
It was quite a meeting.
It's quite a meeting.
And good morning, Ms. Murphy, correct? Ms. Murphy, thank you. Thank you for being here today.
And thank you for having me.
Yes, ma'am.
Gretchen has tremendous shoes to fill. I'm grateful that I still have her as a resource, and I'd like to present our very first elaborate annual meeting. You've gotten annual reports from us before, but this is our first time with our new executive director and our new organization, a 501c3, that we actually are able to present a really nice annual report for you. I do have some that we can hand out, but I will show you where there was a change that we didn't get done, and so I'm having that done, and then I'll make sure that all of you get a copy of this. So without further ado, Gretchen went through our history for us, and for you who don't know the National Ambient Air Quality Standards, they were reduced three times since we started this in 1997, and you guys were a part of it. Our community has worked very, very hard in collaborating together to do voluntary measures beyond compliance to make sure that we stay in attainment. Because as she mentioned, it's gonna cost us all a whole lot more to do business and to run our facilities and run our organizations if we ever go out of attainment. Not to mention the impacts on public health and the environment. So we sat our first board, Sarah Garza with the Port of Corpus Christi. She is the Environmental Planning and Compliance Director for the Port of Corpus Christi, was nominated and elected as our first board president. And so in that package, you'll see that there is a letter from her. And then we are talking about going the distance, the extra mile, meaning going beyond compliance, doing things that are voluntary, and that is the Port of Corpus Christi Operations, CBIA, the agencies, the City of Corpus Christi. the Nueces County, San Pat, because our airshed is both Nueces County and San Pat, and I say that everywhere I go because I don't think people really realize that it's on both sides of the causeway that it is, because air doesn't say I'm just Nueces County air or I'm just San Pat air, but we are in this airshed. EPA has defined the airshed as both Nueces County and San Pat counties, and so we go the extra mile, meaning we do things above compliance voluntarily to make sure we stay in attainment. That's me, the first executive director, just really, really thrilled to be the first executive director. I was a part of this organization as a representative from the City of Corpus Christi. I was the City of Corpus Christi Environmental Affairs Manager for 13 years, and I am just honored to be the first executive director of the Coastal Bend Air Quality Partnership. That it was the name change from the organization of the Corpus Christi Air Quality Group to the Coastal Bend Air Quality Partnership. And it's a partnership because we're all working together to improve the air. Our mission now is to protect the Coastal Bend's air quality and to inspire all emission sources to strive for performance targets beyond general compliance through research, education, and development and distribution of guidance, documents, recommendations, and tools for emissions reducing activities. So if you look on our website, you'll see all kinds of resources that we have for the entire community, not just municipalities and the counties and business and industry, but also for the public as well. This is a picture of our first reception after we sat our board. We had a tremendous reception. Many of you were there. It was amazing. And so we had members of the community, our Errol Summerlin, people from just every walk of life, plus in business and industry, there to celebrate our first elected board and us achieving a 501c3 status. We have a new look. If you go on, you can Google us. We are cbairquality.org. We have a new website. We have a new model. Our theme is Changes in the Air. We did a whole new branding. The CB is our icon. I really would like you to take a look at our new website. We do have offices now, and it's not just at Gretchen's kitchen table. We are official. We are 501c3, making sure that we do all the regulatory compliance as far as accounting. And we're just really excited to continue this great work, but in a larger capacity and reaching out to the entire community. Our achievements thus far, this has been 27 years coming, almost 28 years. I always say nearly three decades. I tell people that we have been doing this for nearly three decades. We are what I have heard from EPA and TCEQ say that when people ask, other communities ask, what can we do to lower our ozone? What can we do? What kind of things can we do? That we, the City of Corpus Christi, the City of Corpus Christi Airshed, and it is the Nueces County and San Pat, I have to keep saying that, that they we are benchmark, that they say, look and see what Corpus Christi area is doing. EPA says it, TCEQ says it. So we're really, really, just really pleased with the accomplishments that we've done. We have all throughout the report, we have a word from our community expressing how grateful they are to the organization and the accomplishments that we have. So when I get that this hard copy to you, you'll see the words that all those in our community have said about our work. Here is our 22 results. The thing that I said where there needed to be a change was 21 and 22. I don't know if they just copied and pasted when they were doing this. This is not the diagram that I sent them on 21 and 22 because we are lower than 60 as far as our three-year rolling average for ozone, the fourth highest on CAMS 1 and CAMS 4 and CAMS 21, which are our continuous air monitoring stations that are located in Toloso and on Airport Road. Those are the regulatory monitors that say whether or not we're in attainment or not. And so 21 and 22 are below 60, and we're having this corrected on us. But as you can see, from where the National Ambient Air Quality Standard was at 85, to be moved down to 75, and now at 70, we still are well, well below. However, the KSAC, which is the Clean Air Scientific Advisory Council, they are mandated to review every 5 years, and so they will be reviewing again what the lowest standard should be in 2025. The last time they looked at moving it to 60, so if you can see, if we are at 60, we are really close to being out of attainment again, and so our efforts, we cannot rest on our laurels. We have much, much more work to do. And so they will be looking at that again in 2025. And of course, we will be commenting because most of the time, if we do have days where we have excursion, it's because we're getting transport air from from the north. And so we really, and that's a double-edged sword too, because if we are gonna say, hey, well, we're nearly not out of attainment because we're getting air from the north, well, everybody, we get our southeast, and so anybody is, that goes north of us and they're getting our wind, then they can say the same thing. So we really, we want to continue to push that, you know, that it is, that we aren't out of attainment because of what was happening here, but because we're getting transport air. But like I said, that's a double-edged sword. Here are our contributors. We thank the CCRTA for all the years that you've stood with us and have made sure that you are helping fund our activities. We've got in-kind support. We've got some restricted funding. We're just really happy with the fiduciary responsibility that we've taken and how we've been really good stewards of the money that you've been giving us thus far. There's a quote from Paulette Gojaldo, who is on our board as well. The City of Corpus Christi is on our board. And all through the report, you will see where different stakeholders have commented on the work that we've done. Looking forward, we are working on a community air action plan, the Coastal Bend Community Air Action Plan. We started with our work group formation in January of 2023. We have 10 work groups, one being transportation. We would absolutely love someone from the RTA to be represented on that work group, because what those work groups do, and they are environmental, public health, public policy, transportation, academia, port operations, industry operations, and these work groups say these are the things that our group, our people in this category can do to voluntarily reduce emissions. And so we'd really, really like to come alongside of you and you to come alongside of us in creating this plan, saying the things that the RTA has done. You are part of our Ozone Advance report, and to continue to help us to get some of your priorities into a plan so that we can get funding for it and so we can put them in action. So we want you to come alongside of us as we develop this plan. We're hoping to have a finalized and approved plan by mid-March to May of 2024, and then publish it and then start implementation at the end of 2024. So please come alongside of us and help us put that plan together. I would love for you to, again, increase your funding, as Gretchen has said, and then to come and help us put this plan together so that your priorities are held as well. Another thing that we're looking forward to is, and there were some, there are our partners there, you see our logos, including this Corpus Christi Regional Transit Authority, our logos, how we've really had partnerships from all, with all of you, and we are really, really grateful for all, because our we could not be successful without you. Here's some more of our comments from our community, people who are involved, actively involved in the Coastal Bend Air Quality Partnership. Here is our board. As you can see, it's a diverse board. We had the county, we had the city, industry, businesses, industries. Dr. Felix is our academic advisor. He is with the Texas A&M Corpus Christi, and he's a brilliant man doing some research that NASA is looking into and NOAA is looking into, and he really, really is helping us really fingerprint on what the next things that we can do to make sure that we stay in attainment. This here, when I look at this now, I said this whole dialogue should have been about Gretchen. She has done a tremendous thing. This is us giving her a thank you for all the work that she's done, all the compliments she's done, and really done it just really humbly and without any fanfare at all. And so if you ever get a chance to really, really talk to her one-on-one in person, she's so humble and she's a much, much gracious woman. And I'm so grateful to still have her as a resource and that she would even come today and present me and speak to you on my behalf and on behalf of the organization. And so you can contact us at this number here, also by email. You did mention your legislative agenda. We will be going to DC, the Coastal Bend to DC part of that delegation, where we will be meeting with the legislatures and those people who are decision makers and the policy makers, and telling them about the wonderful work that we've done together, including the RTCA, the CCRTA. I will make sure I mention you. I'm just really excited to be going at this in September. I hope to see some of you there. And with that, I'll take any questions that you may have.
Any questions for Ms. Murphy?
Great presentation.
Thank you.
Very good. And Gretchen, good job.
Yeah, I didn't get to say hi, Gretchen.
Thank you.
Any questions for Ms. Murphy?
You had a great presentation.
Yeah. Ms. Murphy, I do have one question.
Yes.
Back on your graph, mm-hmm. you know, in 2020, we were trending down, and then all of a sudden in 21, 22, we kind of spiked
I
up.
That
do you know what the background might be on that?
It didn't spike up. That was an error. That was a mistake. That is not the graph I sent them. Not the last two. And they must have copied. And what I'm thinking, they copied and pasted the person.
Oh, that was the one you were talking about.
That's
okay.
The one I was talking
all right. Sorry.
Yeah, so we're fixing it. That's why
I'm
you don't have a hard
guy.
Copy
yeah,
here.
I was,
yeah.
I like graphs.
And we didn't notice it. They didn't notice. Well, I didn't notice it, and we went through it over and over. We had people on the board looking through it and did not see it until we got it printed. And then at my board meeting last week, one of my board members saw it. I was like, oh, my goodness, I didn't see it. And so we're having that redone. So you will get hard copies. But we're below 60
okay.
in both camps for
wonderful.
Both 2022 and 21 and 22. And
wonderful.
Still trending under 60 for 23.
And
as
you think the next limit's going to be about 60?
Well, all so far, like yesterday, our CAMS 4 and CAMS 5 was 61 and 62. And so we've been doing really, really good. The winds help a lot.
Yes, ma'am.
But we still have been doing major things, and you guys included, with changing some of your vehicles, all the things that you do that we put to the Ozone Advanced Report, which is now also the PM Ozone and PM report. So we're looking at that too. And so we're looking at all kinds of measures that we can continue to address all of those. And you guys have been such a big help. But yes, that is going to change. It's been lower than 60, and I'll make sure that you get a copy
great.
Of that.
And we look forward to working with you, especially with our staff and Derek and everybody. They'll be great work. I'm sure y'all be great working together.
Thank you for all you do. Thank you.
I'd like to add, I've had the pleasure of working with Ms. Murphy many times over the years while she's with the city, so I look forward to continuing our partnership and working together. And I have already talked to some of the board members there, so we already have it kind of planned in the works, and we'll talk some more about our staff joining in some of those meetings and also providing our zero emission transition plan that was completed, so that way they can include it in their documentation and regional planning.
I appreciate that, and I saw that one of your priorities, your priority number two, is a primary initiative was clean air planning, and so we can work together and collaborate on that. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. All right, we're on to agenda item 16A, presentations, June 2023 financial report. Robert?
All right. Yes, sir.
All right.
All right,
so sorry, don't want you to hurry, but I want you to hurry.
I'll give you the highlights. So this aligns with board priority of public image and transparency. Just the highlights, our bus advertisement is doing well, investment income and our benefits
are
doing
fantastic.
Second column, our total revenues are projected because sales tax, we won't get that till next week. But are projected to come in about almost $4.6 million. Total expenses come in a little under $4 million, about $638,000 to the positive cash flow. So here's our revenues. Again, sales taxes, the biggest portion of it here. Line item breakdowns and the $304,000 transfer in. We're doing well enough with managing our expenses and our sales tax that we're not going to probably have to bring that in, but that's on a budgeted side. Just breaking up the operating and non-operating revenues, of course, operating revenues are revenues generated by the operations in here, a little over $92,000. The rest of it here, a little over $4 million being generated by sales tax, investment income, grants, Staples Street Center leases. Just the pie chart of where money goes, and I'll just show you here in the next one. So here's the line items in here. Obviously here on expenses, we want them all to be under 100%. Those are above 100% are some benefits. We have a retention program that was put in place prior after the budget was done, so that wasn't factored into it. Materials and supplies, just some parts, gas, and a one-time bus purchase of bus passes. And then purchase transportation slightly above. So our total expenses came in at $3.325 million on a budget of $3.4 million, so we're doing good on expense-wise. Year-to-date, basically the same items on here for highlights. Again, total revenues at $32.3 million on a baseline budget of $31 million, so about $1.3 million better than what we're budgeted for right now at this point. Expenses at $29.5 million on a budget of $30.7 million, so we're about $2,777,000 to the good. Again, about $1.8 million of that would be budget transfers in, which we wouldn't have to do to balance the budget after all, since we're doing well enough. just the revenues breakdowns, kind of mirroring what the monthly would do as a year to date. That was just a graph of this here, of the expenses year to date, $19.3 million on a